trip through Trevor Nelson's Soul Nation.
This is basically, you know, my decade, through my eyes, my story, and I'm going to tell it my own way, really. Soul in the UK started as this tiny little underground scene I was so desperate to be a part of. But by the 80s, when I was old enough to start raving on the scene, to be a soul boy was a little bit embarrassing, you know what I mean?
Right, Saturday night, the gold, man, here we go. Hit it! You leave that out.
I was a soul boy, but the music that I love, jazz funk, had been slowly taken over by the masses. Essex boys and Essex girls.
The jazz funk scene became completely puerile. It was, we used to joke about it because it was the typical cliche of the furry dice and the Kev and Trish kind of thing.
Last night a DJ saved my life. Last night a DJ saved my life. Last night a DJ saved my life. Yeah.
Soul music was deemed to be more like a white thing, very unfashionable. I wasn't dressed as a soul boy simply because I didn't wear tight trousers and carry on like a puff.
Kids like me from the inner city felt alienated as suburban soul fans gathered in their thousands for weekenders at holiday camps like Caister in Norfolk.
I never went to Caister. It was Club 1830. It was people in silly T-shirts and whistles. It looked like a bad wedding.
All these girls with perms and blokes with perms and bib and braces and swirling their handkerchiefs and making human pyramids and whistles, and it was like Butlins on soul. It was disgusting.
A young soul fan called Chris Sullivan decided it was time to bring some class to the scene.
Tuesday night in Kentish Town, North London, and the art college student responsible for bringing fashion back to youth culture and enlivening London's nightlife in the process is getting ready to go out.
I'll watch you go.
At the time in the West End, you have to remember that, you know, most clubs play chart music, really vile stuff. So I just thought, I want to get back to basics here, back to with the roots of it. So I went right back and just started playing the music that I loved when I first used to go to clubs in London, which was mid-70s funk music, which was much harder and more streety than the jazz funk.
An hour later, after changing his clothes yet again, Chris Sullivan is at the door of a Soho club, deciding who should be let in and who kept out from one of the trendier gatherings in London.
In 1981, a new breed of stylish soul boys and girls headed uptown, making their home in the heart of the West End at a club that would become a byword for yuppie exclusivity. The Wag.
I've always liked things that are small and elitist and where you have to know the person to get in. And also, to be honest, because of the way we dressed, and we were pretty extravagantly dressed, it helped to be in Soho, because the only other people there were out of kind of peep shows. So it was kind of a safe area, Soho. There were no beer boys who wanted to beat you up.
It was very dressy up. I mean, I think half the fun was the actual getting ready for it. I mean, I must have taken 2 hours. And that actual whole build-up to a look. I mean, you think, okay, tonight I'm going as a sort of Chinese hostess, circa 1952. And then you'd get in there, and then there'd be someone in a total 1950s Dior look dress. And it's quite ridiculous, all these people in these mad clothes, all dancing to soul music.
It's only elite is if you can't get in. It's great if you're inside.
The music at the Wag drew me like a magnet. Great 70s tracks no one else was playing, like Gene Knight's Mr. Big Stuff.
Mr. Big Stuff. Who do you think you are, Mr. Big
Winston the doorman was Satan to me. Now because you wear all those fancy
clothes. Oh, yeah.
Oh, boy. How you doing, man? You don't remember me.
Of course,
you can't remember me.
Of course not. And I never forget faces.
What was it about me that wasn't cool, then? Because
no, you were cool.
You go to me... Yeah. No, you say no, that was it. No, I knew all about the music. This is the club, this is the club to come to. And I'm like, can't you see? I've got soul in my eyes, man.
You want to go in and enjoy the music. But you're not the first, second, or third individual that I have done that to.
The work wasn't primarily about music. It was about providing an atmosphere for you to pose, show off, have sexual encounters, do drugs, meet your mates, do business deals, whatever it was that turned you on.
I really can't remember being particularly bothered that there was a whole crew of bunch of people trying to get in. I mean, I just knew I'd get in, and I'd get up there, and there'd be people I knew.
Obviously, you know, me coming from Hackney, I'm thinking, you ain't gonna let me because I'm from Hackney. You ain't gonna let me because I'm a little black rug on my foot, or something like that.
There was lots of people we didn't let in. There was no colour thing, but it was something that was levelled at us at one point, which is the most ridiculous statement ever.
Everywhere I go, people still recognise me.
Definitely. You look the same, man.
You know, I ain't changed.
Winston the philosopher. Still won't let me in.
Right.
Remember that first time going into the Wag, even though you're standing in this place that's dingy, grey, unpainted, you would bump into the beautiful people, the ordinary people. It felt good. It felt good to get in there.
The truth was, I was hurt. I was hurt for not getting in. He was telling me I was not cool, and that was the thing that hurt me the most.
It was pure core. If it took the atom from the bomb, it was the Wag Club. It was one club. There was nowhere else.
It was a prototype. The right clothes, the right women, the right drugs.
All these rave kids who think that they invented E in 1986, well, people were doing it 5 years before that, when it was still legal.
There was a lot of MDMA powder snorted, and I can remember people saying, this powder's really fabulous, it makes you very touchy-feely. And I can remember trying it and thinking, I don't want to touch anyone. But that's the first time I took ecstasy, was in the Wag Club.
That was the real kind of thing of the Wag, because no one else in the country had it, and there was a few people that we knew that were bringing it in. Before it was illegalized in America, there used to be T-shirts that used to say, wait 3 days to get married after taking MDM, because everybody would take it, you know, me included, and then go and get married.
The closest I ever got to that world was in the pages of the Face or ID, the new style Bibles.
This scene was obsessed with the way it looked, with the things it danced to, with the labels it wore, with the clubs it went to. And all of that is why the Face took off, because it had a scene to write about. Before 1980, the British thought that style was something bizarre that the French did, a bit like homosexuality. After 1980, style was something that everybody wanted. Charlotte was part of that scene. She was elegant, yet kind of urban. She was black, yet kind of white. She was a bit jazz, a bit soul, a bit pop, a bit funk. Do you know what I mean? All of the things that went into those nightclubs were somehow embodied in her and her band. It was a perfect statement of it all, really. And she kind of looked like she could sing.
She walked out of a nightclub and straight into the top 10. Her first song went to number 6.
She was just an icon straight out of the box. You could see it. Sade was to Soul Boys what Debbie Harry was to the post-punk lot. You'd see girls with the ponytail, the hair pulled real tight back. It was Sade and the earrings. And that was a good look. Don't get me wrong. You pulled a girl who looked like that as a good look.
Sade, I think, epitomised the look. Early Sade, those pictures on the Face, you know, the first ones, that sort of very classic torch singer look. No need to ask, he's a smooth operator.
Every couple of years, there's an act that just appeals to everybody. You know, it's cool enough for all the clubbers and trendies to think it's addressed to them. It's sort of bland enough and tuneful enough for it to be classic couples and dinner party music. And Sade was one of those phenomena. You know, she appealed to absolutely everybody.
She obviously became a badge of so-called good taste, so she ended up in loads of wine bars in like Halifax and places like that. Because it was so championed so much by the so-called style magazines, it lost that underground kind of appeal. It kind of immediately crossed the line into the estate agent's fodder.
The music never had a chance to be underground. Before we could really sort of say, oh, Sade's one of us, she was massive. She'd gone. You bought the album, you didn't live the life. I'd read about it, yeah. Sade's part of the wine bar revolution, and I wasn't, so I didn't care.
Sade isn't exactly protest music.
It's very refined, very silky music, but then so is Let's Get It On, for God's sake. Soul music has always been produced music. It's always been shiny music, if you like.
That music was basically designed for the aspirational chattering classes, designed for the coffee table, to bring in a kind of audience who were basically the children of this boom and bust period, you know, this kind of Thatcherite generation. It was the perfect soundtrack, you know, Filofax soul.
What's wrong with coffee tables? Millions of people have got coffee tables. You know, what's wrong with having a book on there and a Simply Red chat and a Sade CD? You know, it's just that I don't have a problem with it.
A failed punk from Manchester was about to cash in on Britain's appetite for upmarket soul.
I was a soul boy before I was a punk. You know, James Brown and Motown, and we related to it because we were kind of blue collar. Listening to Aretha Franklin is a huge influence on the way I sing. You know, I'd always try and get the notes that she could get, you know, and just practice trying to reach those notes and, you know, kind of, in a way, at that time, kind of copy that style a little bit. It makes me laugh when people say that if you're from the ghetto, man, you have to behave like you're some like ruffian, really angry geezer, when in actual fact, it doesn't have to be that way at all, you know.
Did you feel you were from the ghetto?
Well, I'm not exactly from the pleasant part of town.
Valentine Brothers comes out of a tune, Money's Too Tight to Mention. Then I hear someone's covered it. Mick Hucknall did a decent version. The mere fact it was a cover of a record that was only recently released, it hurt. Anyone who covers a song is asking for it. Could you understand why people like myself were really angry at the time?
In a way, because I was a DJ myself, but it is snobbery. And it's not to be condoned, I don't think.
I actually think Mick Hucknall's version of the Valentine Brothers' Money Too Tight to Mention is not a bad pop song. It's a pop song. And he's a pop singer. He's got quite a nice voice, I actually think, for a ginger boy from Manchester.
I get racism because I'm a redhead. You can't say nigger and packy anymore, but you can slag off redheads. Holding back tears, thinking of the fear I've had so long. When somebody
hears, listen to the fear that's gone. I think Holding Back the Years is a great song. I think it's a great song. It's a great pop song. It's sung extremely well. An original song as well, as opposed to a cover. But Mick Hucknall represented the mainstream of diluted soul music for the masses.
We as an entire unit were very unashamedly mainstream. I believe that music should communicate to as many people as you can get to. In that kind of DJ music journalist world, that the snobbery is comes from, it's too successful, therefore I can't like it. It's too big a hit. I'll keep holding on, holding, holding, holding back.
easy take for you was Nick Hucknall stole the song.
Okay, well, if they're gonna say that, then I'd say, okay, so did Elvis, so did Sinatra, so did Zeppelin. And that's why it mystifies me, because the influence of black American music has been inherent in British pop culture since the 60s. And I look to myself and think, what the hell's the difference? So what, just, is it because I've got red hair again? And what is it?
Soul fans gave Mick a rough ride back in the 80s, but he ended up getting a MOBO Black Music Award.
This is the first century in the history of civilization that's seen the marriage of black culture from Africa and Western European culture. And that marriage has produced many children that are in this room, and I'm one of them.
What Mick Hucknall was doing was great for Mick Hucknall and his fans. It wasn't what we were doing. We didn't have an eye on the national charts. We didn't care if someone was selling millions of records. Yeah, if you wanted to buy it and stick it in your collection. But we wanted to do things that were true to us. In the 80s, being a soul boy was dire. I mean, the charts was full of bland, sort of yucky, yuppie soul. I wanted to DJ, but I thought no way was it going to happen. And even in my own neighbourhood, everyone took the piss out of me.
Back in the day, you almost had to make a choice whether you was into soul music or reggae music. There was a big distinction between the two. Soul music was deemed to be more like a white thing during that period of time. So most soul boys were deemed to be weak, very unfashionable.
In an area like Hackney, reggae dominated. That's all you heard. And every neighbourhood, practically every street, had its own reggae sound system.
That was our claim to fame, being the owner of this great sound system. And you'd beat down any other sound system by having the loudest sound, the sound of clarity, playing the best music, most importantly, having the girls follow you.
The reggae boys just treated us with disdain, scorn, really, you know. They looked at us as different. A lot of cases are soul boys, they're all queer, they're all faggots, you know, that they're all gay.
No way would reggae girls and boys tolerate hearing soul music played on their local sound system, but Norman didn't care.
I was one of the first who dared to be different. I need to play my type of music, so I'm playing my music despite your opposition to it.
But boy, he couldn't really have chosen a worse place to start than a Notting Hill carnival. Is it all over my face? I'm in love dancing.
And springing off the stage. And when now it's seven. What I was doing was basically taboo. One of the tracks I played there, Loose Joints, Is It All Over My Face on West End. No one understood that record. This was some black, gay, New York disco record that I'm playing to straight, young, black yardies. You couldn't ask for a bigger mismatch. And they're like, what's all this soul boy shit? And you know, you were in real danger of losing equipment, you know, if you were young and unknown, trying to muscle in, which we were.
When I came across Norman Jay, he was playing my kind of shit. It was uncompromising. He basically was taking soul music out of the closet at the biggest black music festival in Europe, and I loved it. It became a pilgrimage for me. Every year I had to find good times at Notting Hill Carnival to get my fix. Good times.
We were out in the open air of Notting Hill Street with the full sound system, unrestricted volume levels. And when we played records like Good Times, you felt it, you knew it. I wanted the whole world to celebrate with us and share that music with us.
For a young soul boy like me, it was unbelievable. DJing was the only thing that I ever wanted to do, and now it seemed possible. I was working in a shoe shop and started saving every last penny to put together my soul sound system. A bloke called Jazzy B did the same thing for different reasons.
We just wanted girls, because if there were girls at the dance, like I'm saying, whoa, we don't need to go, I don't need to go nowhere else. Girls like a little bit of this kind of smoochy stuff. So, you know, I wanted to be popular with the chicks. So I'd make sure I was playing the girls' kind of tunes, you know? And everything kind of evolved from there, really. You got it, I know you got soul. Hey, if you didn't, you wouldn't
be in here. I know you got soul. At that time, it was perhaps the most liberating thing to happen in London, which is why it caught the imagination of so many people.
This is a wicked place.
You know that. This brings back an awful lot of memories.
Soul sound systems blew up. Soon Norman was playing massive illegal parties in derelict offices and warehouses.
You'd do anything to get to a warehouse party. You got there. It wasn't you had to get there. You got there and you were there. It was like something that you just didn't want to miss.
He began draining the same Soho clubs that we couldn't get into.
Warehouse parties were fantastic. You could genuinely be as kind of wild as you like. They were usually packed beyond any legal limits, and you're going to be there till dawn, and you're going to cause as much trouble and have as much fun as possible.
We needed an escape route quickly in case the police came.
More often than not, it was a complete and utter dump, with some speakers in a corner, a dustbin for the bar, and often another dustbin for the toilets.
Sweat was actually coming off the walls, just dripping off the walls. It was that packed and that hot.
And I was desperate on a Saturday night. There was no way I was going to the West End looking for a party, right?
Sure.
I'm saying, is Norman playing anywhere? Is XYZ playing anywhere? And then you'd have to make about 6 phone calls sometimes.
Sure.
To find out. And then when you get me somewhere, and it'll be somewhere like this, very little decor, cold, damp, and even a mouse might run over my foot. Yeah. You know, but I'd hear James Brown playing or something and you'd be up there with a tiny little light. And you had a sense of belonging.
I want to get back to down-home funkiness, the music which makes you go, ah, and lose your mind. That's what I want.
Just like Northern Soul 10 years before, we started digging up old records, this time 70s funk tunes.
Maceo and the Max, Across the Tracks. Maceo, one of James Brown's band. Now, anyone who likes James Brown would love this tune. The tune had horns, it had a heavy beat, it was just a great party track. How the hell it wasn't a massive hit, I don't know. The Rare Groove Revival made that tune, gave that tune life.
The Rare Groove thing, because it was elite, it was like obscure kind of music that was more pulsating, and I think you could flex a little bit more listening to that.
Track after track after track, classic track that you thought, how could they possibly know?
So it was old music, but it was brand new to us. Brothers on the slide.
Rare Groove had something to say to you. If you were living under Thatcher in the 80s, these were hard times. And the same thing happened with the clothes we were wearing.
I always said the girls dressed like the boys in London, man, at that time. Camden look, everyone was in black, crew necks and polo necks and jackets.
But it was a functional look. There was no heating in places like this. You had to dance to sweat to get warm. Yeah.
Black DMs, Levi 501s, white T-shirt or shirt, black MA1 flying jackets, and a flat top usually done at Andy's in Kentish Town.
The hard times look and that whole warehouse scene went together, because you could fall over in it, crash out on the floor in it, and it didn't look any worse when you got up.
Ripped jeans were the thing that everyone wanted to do, and, you know, try and see where you could get the most explicit rips. You know, whether it be under your bottom or, you know, your knee was quite a good one. I mean, I sat and burnt my jeans quite a few times just to get the right rips in the knee.
There's one famous warehouse party in King's Cross that was very, very cold, and it was a very cold concrete floor. And there was a point when people were literally sort of strapping tin cans, flattened beer cans, onto the bottom of their shoes to dance. So it sounded like a whole bunch of tap dancers on the go.
Ghetto,
a nice shot, isn't it? If you get 4,000 people down here and you're up there, come on! I mean, you know.
We were the first people to kind of get all the differing music, style, fashion tribes together.
There wasn't the same kind of animosity as there had been. I think it was the start of London starting to come together as a city, where you'd have a whole contingent of Sloanes who'd come down dancing next to a whole bunch of Hackney kids.
There was a lot of the ignorance sort of went out about colour and race, and we all sort of integrated really well.
There was an immediate breakdown of a lot of barriers, class and racial, which for me was big motivation.
You see that black boy over there running scared, his old man in a bottle.
For the first time, everyone was partying together, and the mix came in handy when there was trouble.
You just have this sort of middle-class white guy on the door for when the old Bill turned up and he'd speak to them.
The blag was, you know, we're college kids, it's end of term, you know, we're having a college bash.
Those guys ended up in the nick once or twice. But the parties would still go on.
And don't you think it's a crime when time after time after time people in a bottle, there's people living in a bottle.
Yeah, it was illegal, but it was innocent, and no one had a clue what we'd started. In the late 80s, soul, rear groove, was exactly what we needed. The antidote to chart music, which was horrible. But the underground had its enemies.
I think it was inverted snobbery. I think DJs were more important than the music, and they were more important by finding the rarest record in the world.
If you're in confusion, here's the solution. Find the money. You can't get
it was all Mel and Kim and Bananarama. And the pop Svengali behind all those acts was about to teach us a lesson.
I went away in my own brain and said, I'll prove they're not listening. I'll prove, you know, they're becoming bigoted. That's the word I'm looking for. They're becoming bigoted.
Picture this. Recording studio somewhere far, far away.
Robot was a really cool record. I mean, everybody loved it from the get-go.
We just made the record pretty well overnight, just as a fun thing. I mean, it was 10 hours to make the thing.
Everybody was playing it. It was like, you put it on, bang, the floor was full.
We literally got all the tape pots in the building. We took all the trays out of the dishwasher full of cups, saucers and cutlery. And we all stood around a microphone. They were all shaking this cutlery. And all everybody was stomping on the floor saying, Roll Black. It was magical. You could just hear it. It worked.
No one knew where this record had come from. It had no credits on it at all.
I just thought it was a great record, but I knew it was a new record. You know, because a record that funky, if that had been out in 1975, I'd have heard it. I'd have known about it.
At first, it was only a joke when the demand for this record was fantastic. I put it out at Stock Aitken Waterman and said, now, there you go. And of course, everybody was in uproar. I mean, everybody was in uproar because people said they got the original.
That fooled all the wannabes who claimed to have been around at the birth of funk. Anyone who knew of my age wouldn't have been fooled by that.
When I found out it was Stock Aitken Waterman, I laughed my head off. I really did, and I just thought, well, if they can make records like that, why don't they do it every day then?
Yeah, he showed Rear Groove fans up, made us look a bit foolish, but that wasn't going to stop us. Britain's black DJs had taken over the city with massive parties. We were about to invade the airwaves.
It was just going to be a one-off, but so many people heard it. Now we had a platform to play music that we liked.
Without a doubt, it was the sound of London. Almost every stall, every shop would have Kiss on.
We're always briefed to look around to see if anybody is about. You know, there's lots of kind of black Mariahs and strange cars with strange aerials sticking out of them.
We had many close shows, but that was part of the appeal in the beginning, the whole risk element.
This is where it all happened. This is where it all started.
Kiss was where it all started for me as a radio DJ. Just the word pirate That really appealed to me.
It was organised chaos. It was about getting in safely, not being seen, and playing music. You know, letting the ego take over.
I remember us being off air because I was convinced we'd been busted, but we hadn't. And I can remember, you know, white noise for like an hour while I was lying on the floor with all the lights off in the studio, thinking that they were in the building. It might have been the substances I was taking at the time, but I'm not quite sure about that.
Stand by for Mad Hatter Trevor with The Sound of Music, The Sound of Soul.
Hi, brother. What time are you getting there tonight?
What time do you want me?
When I first got my own show, Jesus, I had to pinch myself. I couldn't believe it. If I wanted to play half an hour of James Brown, I could. Complete freedom.
A typical early Kiss broadcast was pandemonium, chaos. I can remember pulling up on the South Circular in my car and cracking up laughing because they were so bad.
If occasionally we slipped up and said the F word or, you know, a record sounds so great you lift a needle, I can play it again. Yeah, why not?
There were a couple of DJs that were so terrible that they couldn't really get a job in Sainsbury's hailing out special offers. They were that poor.
Got the adverts queued up?
No, I'm a bit late with those.
OK, it was amateur, but for the first time ever here, you could turn on the radio day or night and find black music. But by the end of the 80s, I'd had enough of the underground. It was time for black British soul to go legit.
God almighty, it looks tiny now.
It's like when you go to school, isn't it, and everything's really changed.
Look at this place, man.
In 1987, at the height of the warehouse scene, I finally got to DJ in the West End.
Let's get some lightage.
No one would believe this was a club.
Sunday night at the African Community Centre, run by a bunch of likely lads called Soul to Soul. Not for a second did any of us guess they were about to explode into Britain's greatest ever soul act.
Soul to Soul is the place where you should be. On Sunday nights with H&U and Jazzy B. Cause it's all about expression. Cause it's all about expression.
Was it Fair Play, the first record?
Yeah, that was the first record.
And we were still playing here when that came out.
That's right. In actual fact, some of the filming was done in there.
Yeah. That's what centre was like.
God's all about expression.
There'd be a queue all the way down the street. I think, why hasn't he opened the doors yet? And I get in there and I feel the heat. And I think, is it ramming there already? There'd be no one in there. You'd be just tweaking the bass like this, leaving everyone getting drenched outside. And I'm like, what a bastard. And you're like, no, Trevor, just got to get the bass right.
That's right. That whole thing about anticipation. So everybody was in wait. Oh, gotta get in there. And then whenever they did get in there, then that was it. It was live.
It worked.
For me, heaven. I really was euphoric. I did not want to leave.
Do you remember that time though when we stopped the dance halfway through and asked everyone to leave so the rest of the people could get in?
I can't believe you did. No, we didn't. You did. See, the difference is it was your club, not mine.
Could you ever see the floor? The Soul to Soul video was genuinely a rave. Because, I mean, it was annoying me that I was on the stage and I wanted to be down there having a funky vibe.
What did you say every single week?
Well, the classic was, if you're not dancing, fuck off.
So you come to this club for the first time, you're standing there and you're telling them to fuck off.
And then you had Jazzy up there going, and if you're not dancing, off. Got me said. But, you know, and which was what it was about. It was about dancing. It was about expression. So to me, it was brilliant. I didn't want to go home.
You paid me 30 quid a night.
60,
Trev. £30 a night.
What are you doing with that other 30?
Every time I hear one of your stories, I'm always like doubling it. No, you should be proud. You're the only person that ever played me 30 quid a night. I would have paid you to play it.
Those were the days.
Soul to Soul. First they ran a club night, then they became a group and a fashion label.
You did this, and everything you ever said was bigger than it was.
Right.
Would you agree?
Not at all.
Oh, God, you did.
It's just perception that this guy's got is just incredible.
You were like the Black Branson, weren't you? But yeah. Before you had two.
I think that Jazzy was probably Puffy before there was a Puffy. Very good on the whole resale fashion wear stuff, and the artwork was really good. And they had their own store. I thought that was pretty fantastic. For me, Jazzy was pretty special in that way.
For everybody who can remember the Africa Centre. Centre of the world.
It was just heaven. Doesn't sound it, does it? But it was absolute heaven. I mean, I've never played anywhere like it since.
For us, it was like our cabin club. The things that went on in here were like unrestricted, you know, it was like freedom of everything. So scoff at it. If you're watching this, you can laugh all you like, but for me, this is it's like I've died and gone back to heaven.
America has ruled us musically, fashion-wise, forever and a day. The only place I've ever wanted to go to was America for that reason. And then Soul to Soul came along and I didn't have to bother because we were doing our own, and it was our own. It was distinctly British.
I remember at the end of the night, you'd always see people just slumped like this, and it would only be like 2:30, but they'd be so exhausted. Girls' hair would just go frizzy, and they'd be sitting there like this, having a cigarette or something, or other things, and just not wanting to move, not wanting to go home.
What Soul to Soul did was take all the ingredients of a great night out and put them on a record. It had rear groove, hip-hop, even a touch of reggae.
Between us, we created hip-hop soul, the very first hip-hop soul. Before Mary J, there was us.
We'd cut two records before, which were fantastic cult records, but we were missing the pop edge. We were missing somebody who was a real singer.
With Karen Wheeler in the equation, Jazzy was convinced he'd found his soul diva.
At the point before I met Jazzy, I just basically gave up. I was working in the libraries in Southwark. I didn't see the point in singing because I didn't think anybody wanted to hear my voice, because I didn't fit the criteria of the typical pop superstar. People told me, cut off your dreadlocks, but the idea of cutting off my hair didn't hit home with me.
When I wrote Keep On Moving, it was the night that they tried to close us down at the Africa Centre. And I'd literally written the song sitting in the van, almost sobbing.
To this day, I personally haven't seen Jazzy play anything. I don't know if he's a musician or not. Maybe he is. I've never seen him play anything but the triangle, so I couldn't really say. I didn't think Keep On Moving was going to be a hit, to be honest with you. I'm not going to join the crews of people like, I knew it. No. You know why? Because it was so, to me, it sounded so regular black. It sounded like a black underground tune. I couldn't see it crossing over, only because it just seemed so us. It seemed like so kind of underground.
It was such a turning point. The summer when Keep On Moving was released was just one incredible time. You could feel something was happening with that record. You could feel that there was a shift of musical power happening. Pumping out of cars, out of shops. It was played everywhere.
Karen Wheeler was singing, yellow is the colour of sun rain. And that made me stop.
When Soul to Soul had a number one, I felt like I had a number one, really. Simple as that.
And I've got friends who were pregnant at the time who basically said they were sick of that song because it basically played right through their pregnancy, and it's like the baby pretty much come out singing the song.
Yes. By 1989, even the British pop establishment seemed ready to embrace Soul to Soul.
Soul to Soul were a breath of fresh air. They were a superb band. They made a brilliant, brilliant record. Probably one of the best British soul records of all time. Probably the greatest soul record of all time.
After years of being treated like a wuss for being into soul music, Soul to Soul came along, made it street, they made it stylish, and they made it credible. Not just in Britain, but everywhere.
What are your recollections of Soul to Soul?
I just remember I was waiting for Keep On Moving to come on the radio. And then what was the second big single?
Back to Life.
Back to Life.
Back to life, back to reality.
I just remember loving her voice. She could sing. And then when you would see them on TV, like Jazzy B and how they looked, and I just loved it. Because locks in America were not as widely accepted. People in my family had locks, but you never saw anyone on TV.
What was significant about being big in America was that, apart from Loose Ends, nobody had really sort of dented the market as far as a black group or black-based British act was concerned.
The British Record Industry Awards, The Brits 1990, and Soul to Soul.
After 30 years of trying to be as good as the Americans, a British sound proved to be as good as it got. Soul to Soul won 2 Grammys in the US, and it seemed like a new dawn for UK soul. But at home, it was a different story.
The record company and everybody thought we were going to win an award because we were actually performing at the Brits. And Lisa Stansfield won the award. Everybody was outraged. And I can remember Naina Cherry walking up to us and literally breaking her award in half and presenting us with one half, and she kept the other half. And that was as close as we got to any British awards.
We got Grammy Awards, but we didn't get recognised in Britain, and I thought that was a big disrespect, a big diss.
And the winner is Lisa Stansfield.
No disrespect to Lisa, but she was rolling off our sound.
Soul to Soul got their reward when they went multi-platinum around the world. It was like pandemonium, like the gold rush. Record companies were chopping their arms off to sign the next Soul to Soul. When I heard Apparently Nothing, I freaked. I was like, wow, this is just as good as anything Soul to Soul's made. I love this record. This record is superb. This record should be number one.
The fact that mainstream picked up on it was a very strange thing because we didn't fit. You know, we didn't dress like everybody else. You know, we didn't have the same outlook.
But it was too groovy, it was too funky, it was too pure, you know, and that was probably why it didn't quite cross over, and they were just a bit too cool.
That was a challenge for UK artists. Could you sell records without selling out, selling your soul? An 18-year-old from near Croydon had the gall to think he could. He went on to write a huge tune, but almost didn't get signed.
If I had to say one person in the whole of the UK influenced more musicians than any other in terms of black music, I'd say it was Omar.
I love Omar. He just has something. I think of the African influence with American soul influence. That's what I always hear. Even the way that the bass rides, especially the way the bass rides.
I just, you know, started with the bass line. And then I did the drums, and then the keyboards, and then the strings. And I remember I stopped about 5:30 in the afternoon and bought myself a drawer and then wrote the lyrics. I wrote the song in a day. Sip a glass of cold champagne wine. The rug that we lie on feels divine. Somebody told me that they didn't expect a song like that to come from Fort and E. No.
It was like a good stew. It's got the right ingredients in it, and it's exquisite, you know. It was something very special.
We went to a lot of record labels for them to put it out, and nobody wanted to take it out because they said, no one's doing this, we can't sell this. Luckily, my dad had a label at the time, so, you know, we managed to put out some copies.
I had a word with my wife and discussed with her the possibility of remortgaging our house, and she was well behind it. So that's what we did to raise the money to record the album. And I must say, I did have faith in it, you know, or else we wouldn't have done it, of course.
When you hear something that is as good as what Omar is, it's like, who is that? Ooh, like that, like I'll spend my last $15 on that CD. And I have a lot of friends who love Omar the same way I do. There's nothing like this. There's nothing like this.
first single blew up. It was a classic, but Omar's later albums just didn't do as well. The British public didn't take him to their hearts.
Second time I came to London, they had the jam in the park. I stayed actually an extra day because I wanted to see Omar. 50 people were in the Omar tent. 50 people. Every song I was just like, making sense of it. And then when they played There's Nothing Like This, the whole audience was like, oh, and I was like, they should love him more over here.
Apparently all the American artists when they come over here always quote me as someone that they listen to, which is nice, but it's only them that's listening to it. I need the whole American public to know about it as well. That hasn't happened for me yet, but hopefully it will happen in the future.
Without doubt, I think if he released exactly the same material at a different time, he probably would have been a much bigger artist, because he was like the forerunner. The cynics would say he didn't write crossover songs. Omar never compromised his sound. You know, he didn't make that record that Taxi Driver's Love.
I guess Britain still preferred its soul from America. That was a feeling.
Trying to be Alexander O'Neill or Luther Vandross. And I just don't think you can beat Luther Vandross or Alexander O'Neill. They were who they were. You know, and the great thing is, you know, again, Soul to Soul didn't do this. You can't be pseudo-American.
Just on that quote alone, he knows fuck all about English soul or black music in England, because I don't know what the fuck he's listening to. Do you know what I mean? And if he thinks he can compare me to Alexander O'Neill, what the fuck's he talking about?
The one British artist who made it big from the warehouse scene was Jamiroquai.
Why did Jamiroquai make it and Omar didn't? He had catchier pop funk songs. He stuck to the formula. He nailed it. And he's a complete showman. And he did consistently write records that were going to be hits.
Despite the hype, no one else cracked it.
British soul was, you know, the talk of the town. Everyone wanted to sign it. It was going to happen. And there's a whole new movement. Didn't quite happen. It just really didn't quite happen. In fact, what did happen was the emergence of house music.
What subverted that whole situation was, on the street level underground, the shift of the power base from traditional sort of artists to house or club music.
There were children in baggy lilac clothes, out of their heads, gurning to music made by Germans. And I just thought, this is over.
House music enjoyed so much success because finally there was music that Europeans could move to.
Close friends of mine were selling up their soul music collections to either become house DJs or just to rave on that scene. To my disgust, of course, I was like, you can like it, but don't sell your collection. What was it all for? You know, where were we heading?
Did house kill soul? Nah, not at all.
Because by the end of the 90s, UK soul will be back from the grave. We were about to reinvent R&B. We were about to create not just one great band or a couple of hits, but a whole new UK sound.
A double CD, Trevor Nelson's Soul Nation, featuring tracks from the show, is in the shops. To order, call 0870 1234344 or visit channelforward.com/shop. Spectacular DJ performances in Form Music this week, plus the AAAs and Foo Fighters. That's late Saturday. Next tonight, we're live in the Big Brother house. I know you got
by Sunday, so it could be...